balls, new from Red Rooster.
Mario!
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 Super Mario 1, 2, and now the world's hottest Super Mario 3! Only from Mattel, Nintendo! Now you're playing with power!
The alpacas absolutely loving it, ladies and gentlemen. Now, our first guests come from a very famous American show business family. Their grandparents were singing stars and had their own sitcom. Their father was a teenage idol, and they're currently in Australia to promote their debut album, After the Rain. Please welcome Mathew and Gunnar Nelson, ladies and gentlemen. Sorry, guys, I should have gratuitously held this up first off.
The shameless plug. There you go.
Let's get that shameless plug right out of the way there. That's what you need to buy. Although it's funny, isn't it? People would probably be familiar with this album now because it was released, what, a year ago?
About 9 months ago, actually.
I was just going to say...
You're the host. Go ahead.
You had that... I keep forgetting that. You had that a great hit with Love and Affection, and then it's taken until now. What happened?
Actually, our record company was sold right after we released Love and Affection. It went to number 17 on the charts down here.
Mm-hmm.
And David Geffen decided he wanted to own amusement parks and a bit
hotels
of Coca-Cola
and
the whole thing. So he sold his company, and we were left without a company down here in Australia. There was nothing we could do at the time, so we just kept on with our tour back in the States.
It must be so frustrating.
Oh, yeah, it is.
It is, because we worked a long time on this record. We put about 4 years of work and travel and writing into it. And never in our wildest imagination would we think that something like that could happen.
Well, it's funny, too, because as I said in your intro, you both, you know, showbiz family, and over generations, you'd think if anyone could have seen the pitfalls of contracts and big corporations, it could have been you guys.
David never told anybody. He just kind
of
did it, you know. He didn't...
Hey,
really
what a heck of a
Dave
guy.
Didn't consult us, you know.
Damn, yeah. You're probably on the road, busy.
You know, there's really not much you can do, literally. I mean, you got to start someplace, and all starting artists, regardless, usually have to make a few concessions with that contract.
Yeah. You know. So is it weird now? I mean, I'm sure that musicians come out of the studio and go, gee, that was our album, it's great. And then 2 months down the track, go, you know, we could have done this, and on our next album, we'll do that.
Yeah.
But you guys sort of haven't been able to do that, in a sense, because you've got to go back and talk about this album.
Actually, it's good. This album was really created, first and foremost, from our trip down here to Australia. We came here about 3 years ago.
Yeah, that's right.
And it was really our first experience abroad, and that really helped us out with our songwriting. And with the direction that we wanted to take with our project as a whole, I think Australians in general are a lot more positive than Americans, and
that's
a lot
great.
More colorful. And so we wanted to go against the grain in our home country and reflect that in music, so it helped.
Oh, that's good. So are you actually going to be touring here soon?
That's kind of what we're doing here. Not only are we trying to get the ball rolling again.
This is the hearts and minds stage of the tour, isn't it?
Right. We're just trying to get everybody excited enough to warrant us coming down and playing, because that's really what we do and what we'd like to be doing.
Well, yeah, actually, just that'll gratuitously lead us into More Than Ever, which is the second single now off the album. Let's have a look at the clip, and you'll see the guys sort of playing live, sort of. Their video clip, sort of.
It's live. It's a live thing.
Is that what the concerts are like?
Yes, that's okay.
Because you guys have just come off a 9-month tour.
Yeah, and we're out a while, yeah.
What sort of size venues are you playing?
It varied. In the beginning, it was all theaters, and that worked pretty well.
2,000 to 3,000 for about 45 shows, and we went out with Cinderella, a little heavier tour, for about 6 weeks. We were playing, I think, 6,000 to 8,000 seaters, and then wound up the tour doing anywhere from 4,000 to 10,000.
Isn't it funny? Just because of the history, you know, with your record company and stuff, I guess people in Australia would know you mainly as, well, let's be blatant, freeloaders who come here every time there's an opening.
That's right.
The Nelsons drinking heavily, going,
right.
Must get a record out here one day. But in fact, you guys have been playing live for almost all your life. I mean, what, the first gig was when you were 13?
Well, that's when we really started actively playing in the clubs in Los Angeles. We were, you know, sporadic days before then.
Doing the recording and stuff.
Yeah.
What was it like playing in clubs at 13?
It was rough. You couldn't invite any of your friends.
Well,
you
sure, there's that.
Everybody was...
Come to a birthday party. It's at a club on Sunset.
Yeah, really. It was a good experience, though. It was good for us. We actually... we lobbied to have a law instated in Los Angeles that underage, you know, up until that point, underage kids weren't allowed to play in clubs at all. And we knew that was going to be a problem, having to wait 6 years to play live. So
yeah.
I think it was beneficial also because it enabled us to get experience in front of an audience that wasn't there to see us.
Yeah.
You know, that the conversion factor. And that's something that we always try to bring to the shows anyways.
Yeah. So you obviously enjoy playing live?
Oh, love it. Oh, yeah. Love it. We're show-offs. That's great.
Yeah, the flash spots, the power chords. Yes, bring them on.
Yeah.
So what are you guys going to do? Like, you've done this promo tour. You did the big tour just before that. Are you going to have a holiday at all? Are you going to take a break?
Well, we were going to go up to Daydream Island, do a little bit of diving if we can work that into our schedule.
All right.
And then we have to go to Taiwan and Japan and then back home and then back to Japan and then to Brazil. And
no rest for the wicked. You know how it is.
Yeah, sure, sure. It's not so much the music. It's for all those free tour T-shirts.
Actually, it's for the frequent flyer miles.
Oh, yeah, of course. You've got to clock that up. You could get a fabulous barometer in a horse's stomach.
I could get a set
of
pens or something like that.
Yeah, nifty. That's exactly what you need. Well, guys, sit there. Actually, a little later on, I might actually get you to play. Play live. So we'll bring the guitars and stuff. Keep watching. When we come back, Richard Marx, the Nelson Brothers, and more. This is live from Outer Australia. Yes, that's Alex getting to know Harvey the Wonder Dog. How are they going? It looks pretty cool. I think the cat's going to take out the dog, quite frankly. He's got that look, get away, or you're going to get the claw thing over the nose. Richard Marx has the unique distinction of being the first solo artist in American rock history to reach the top five with each of his first seven singles. They include tracks like Hold On to the Night, Endless Summer Nights, Right Here Waiting and Satisfied. His first two albums sold more than 10 million copies. Quite frankly, I think he's getting the hang of this. He's in Australia to promote his new album, Rush Street, and tonight he's singing Keep Coming Back. Please welcome Richard Marx.
Thank you. come behind the scenes with the amazing technology of Rice Cam.
Let's just slow down the bicep here.
Channel 7's invention could soon be heading into space.
Oh, incredible.
Plus, the latest way you could explore Earth's last frontier.
The leisure vehicle of the future.
The science of catching a criminal.
It'll identify the criminal with an accuracy of millions to one.
See how DNA fingerprinting can solve a mystery.
The genetic fragments from the suspect found at the scene of a crime.
Telecom and the SGIO present Beyond 2000, Tuesday.
For everyone who enjoyed Virginia Andrews' books, there's a new bestseller that will keep you up reading, well, until dawn. But you can only get it at Angus and Robertson. So don't go searching other bookshops for dawn till dusk.
The only thing that looks as good as an IKEA sofa is an IKEA price. The IKEA sofa collection starts from a very comfortable $650.
Here's a great buy from Motor.
Cassette, our standard.
Oh, what a feeling.
New Seeker Olympic Edition.
Here she comes, just like an angel. Seems like forever that she's been on my mind. But nothing has changed. She thinks I'm a waste of her time. There she goes. No, she don't know what she's missing. Can't she see I'll never give the fight? I'll do all I can till she understands my design.
That's great. Have you got another album ready to go? Because as we said, it's been a little while since you did the last one.
We've been doing a little writing and stuff like that. What we really want to do, and something we learned with the process of this first album, is take the time to really reflect on the experiences we've had in the last couple of years, because they've been pretty heavy.
So you can't sort of... a nice way of describing it. You can't sort of... write while you're on the road, you need to sort put yourself in an attic, going to write a classic.
I don't know anybody that's really a musician that's on the road and is able to write. I've talked to a lot of them. Oh, look, they're getting up.
The alpacas are moving.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's movement at the
Nelson
station.
Nelson is showing us his best side again.
Yeah, Nelson. It's about Nelson.
Way to go, pal.
Mention to him later.
Yeah, I think there's going to be a time for us to sit down and really concentrate on the writing and all that stuff.
What's he doing? Don't ask.
Okay.
Let's put it this way, he's definitely a Nelson. No, Nelson, out from behind there, son. Do you have troubles when you're writing? Because, of course, you write together. Do you bicker about... No, don't put that word there.
Not
rhymes
usually.
Are June.
It's a good question. Usually one of us will come with the initial inspiration, like a chord chord progression or something like that, and then we'll go off of it. And we do collaborate pretty much 50-50 on everything.
It's kind of like playing a game of tennis with somebody. Just the ball keeps going back and forth until you get something you're happy with.
Something I wanted to ask you. My older brothers are identical twins.
Uh-oh.
And they went through... So I know what it's like, you know, to have... you're always the twins, and there's the twins. And it's always a bit of a nightmare. And they went through phases where they desperately wanted to look... different to each other. Did you ever go through a phase where one of you had a